If you recognize a familiar face on the podium with me today, perhaps it's because you recognize Lawrence Otis Graham from his TV conversations with Charlie Rose or Chris Matthews, or from appearances on the Today Show or Good Morning America. If the name Lawrence Otis Graham sounds familiar, perhaps it's because you have read one of his 14 books. Our Kind of People is now in its 13th printing, and Netflix will use it in an upcoming series. Perhaps you are like me and remember the young and successful lawyer, Larry Graham, on the cover of the New York Magazine, not in his attorney role, but as an undercover busboy at the Greenwich Country Club. That $7 an hour job led to the bestseller, Member of the Club, and the story that he told ended discrimination in clubs all over the United States. Larry Graham calls himself a cultural troublemaker. In the present turmoil of the world, advice from a cultural troublemaker will serve you graduates well, class of 2017, so listen carefully. Today, we give a warm welcome to Lawrence Otis Graham, renowned lawyer, best-selling author, historian, and best of all, he is the father of Gordon 2014 and Harrison 2017, who is graduating today. Larry.
Oh boy, how am I going to live up to that introduction? Andy, thank you so much for inviting me here to join all of you today. And I'm honored to have been asked to speak at this 95th commencement for the class of 2017. To our hardworking headmaster, Andy Chase, to the Chase family, to Rachel Blaine, who despite where she's standing, she brings it. I mean, this woman brings it. And I always look forward to her invocations, her benedictions, and just the warmth that she brings and the organization that she brings to this school. I want to thank the faculty, the staff, who's always been there for us, to the administrators, these wonderful trustees, some are here, some are out there, the alumni who come back and give to this school, even though they have no children here, and to the parents and the families who support all of you. And I want to thank all of you for making Eaglebrook such a wonderful institution, a safe place, a place that provides us comfort and security. And really, for parents like myself and my wife, Pamela, never even knew of the existence of a junior boarding school until Harrison was coming. We were driving home from Wolfboro Summer Boarding School, and it was August 16th or 17th, and Harrison says to me, "Are we going to boarding school?" And I said, "Of course not. You're going into the sixth grade at Horace Mann. You've been at Horace Mann since nursery school. You're staying at Horace Mann. We sent the money to Horace Mann. You're staying there." He said, "Well, I'm interested in it because I met some students at Wolfboro, and they told me about this great all-boys junior boarding school." I said, "I've never heard of such a thing." So we came home, and he went right to the computer, and this is the young man that introduced me to this institution, so I will always be grateful. Now, when Harrison and Gordon arrived here, they made me make two promises, and one, which I've already broken, was give us space, and two, I've also broken, don't embarrass us. So I was one of those New York helicopter parents that was always there. So I guess the best thing they could ever have done was to have broken free and come up here to Eaglebrook. So And this advice that they were giving me about give them space was very valuable because it is important. This is a safe space where our kids can fall, can make mistakes. And as a parent and a trustee, I look back at these years and I think about the sit-down meals that they would tell us that were over in the Gibbs Dining Hall. They would tell us about home night, about hiking up to the Rock, which I think there was even a hike late last night or early this morning, and about the building of sleds during the winter carnival, the bonding with the dorm faculty, bonding with their families, bonding with their children, their family pets. And this is a gift that we have been given as parents that our children might not have had. And I think in many ways, they've been given a 360 degree view of what the real world looks like, where they're coming from all around the world. I used to think that my kids were being introduced to everything being in this ritzy school in Manhattan. And then I realized, yeah, there's the Upper East Side, there's the Upper West Side, and there's the people from the suburbs. But here we have people from all around the world, and it's a wonderful experience and a wonderful opportunity that we've given our children. So before I go much farther, I I'm going to ask the 87 graduates in front of me a question, because about 3 weeks ago, I gave the commencement address at Penn State University. And before I got there, the chancellor of the university said, "Lawrence, I need to see a copy of your speech." I don't know if he thought I was a cultural disruptor, shit stirrer, I don't know what you call it, whatever. Okay. You could blank that tape, Skylar, right? Okay, beat me up. And I don't know if they were concerned I was going to talk about Donald Trump or Justin Bieber or Miley Cyrus or whatever the case was, or drop a, you know, a curse word. And I wasn't going to do any of that. But at the same time, I should say, your headmaster actually did not ask me to give him a copy of the speech. So, given that, I have this other speech right here because I thought I wasn't sure if he was actually going to say. So, I've got this thing where I can give you a speech that's straight down the middle, safe, doesn't rock the boat, and everyone will be happy. Oh, yeah, that, and you'll forget it by the time you get up to Flagler dorm to pack to go home. Or I can give you the plan B speech here. That so I'm going to ask you, what do you want? This is going to rock the boat. Which do you want? Plan A, the safe vanilla one, or the plan B? There you go. I was hoping it was. Okay. I did this because I thought, well, maybe Andy or Rachel say, well, do you want us to make a copy of the speech or give to Elaine to put out here? And I thought, just in case, I'll keep plan B in my pocket so they wouldn't see it. So, okay, so here we go. My message to you today is that when you go out into the real world, when you leave this campus, go out there and go do the thing that you think that you cannot do. This is a phrase by Eleanor Roosevelt, who was the first lady to Franklin D. Roosevelt. She was always stirring up stuff back in the 30s and 40s. And go do the thing that you think that you cannot do. What I mean by that is go face a challenge that you say, I don't know if I'm going to be able to succeed in this, but I think it's worth trying. You know, whether it's a sport, whether it's an activity, whether it's a club, whether it's a summer camp, whether it's taking a class that you thought, I was never good at that at Eaglebrook, but you don't have to be pigeonholed about what you did here at Eaglebrook. You can reinvent yourself when you go to your next school. The great thing about Eaglebrook is that this is a safe environment for you to have taken chances, but if you hadn't taken some of these chances, go try them, go take them now. When I was 12 years old, I really wanted to run for vice president of the seventh grade. Big ambition, right? Okay, and I said to my friends, I'm thinking I'm going to run for vice president in seventh grade. And they said, Larry, you'll never win vice president. And they said, you know, you're not on a sports team. You're not popular. You know, you're not tall. You're too afraid to even go talk to the girls at the mall. Remember the mall? And they said, you'll never do it. So I thought, okay, that was 60 seconds. They did away with my ambitions to be vice president. But the tragic thing was not so much that they said that to me, but that I bought into it. And you're often going to find people. They might be frenemies, strangers, or even people that actually want to protect you from hurting yourself. They don't want you to go out there and challenge yourself because they're afraid that, you know, you will fall and might get hurt. I know I was one of those parents that said, oh, no, don't try that. You might get hurt. That might be too much for you. Go try that, because if you take advice from your parents and you know that they're going to keep you safe, that's all you need to know. But there are challenges out there that are worthwhile stirring the boat and rocking the boat and stirring the pot, because sometimes you'll find a strength inside of you that you didn't even know was that was there. I know that despite that, I should also add, I was one of those oboe players, and that was another sort of check mark against me for, like, I'd never be vice president because oboe just wasn't cool back then. I don't know if it is now. It did help me get into Princeton and Harvard Law School, so I have to say that. But sometimes you will find also that you will find yourself in situations, and Andy made a reference of when I went undercover as a busboy at a country club in Greenwich, Connecticut. And some people might say, why would you do something like that? And it actually goes back from my history, from when I was growing up. I went to a high school in a rather well-to-do community outside of New York. And this high school was very well known for being very diverse by having, although it was a mostly white high school, we had Latinos and African-Americans and Asians and a diverse group of people. But the problem was, when you walked into the dining hall, that's when you saw what was really going on, because there was the Jewish boys' table, the Protestant blonde-haired girls' table, the Irish Catholic boys' table, and the black boys' table, which was shared with the Puerto Ricans. And at the end of it, there were a few Asian boys that would sit there. And so it was just an absolute, some people would say, well, this isn't this the melting pot? That's not the melting pot. And what was so tragic to me is that when I started there, my brother was 2 years ahead of me, and I said, where am I supposed to sit? Because we lived in this Jewish neighborhood, so I knew all the Jewish boys that lived on our street. And then he said, you got to sit over here at the black boys' table over here with me. And so some of my Jewish male friends were waving to me, Larry, come over here. And I thought, oh my gosh, this is where we actually find out who we are. And it's not so much the decision that you make, it's the fact that oftentimes we feel we don't have the choice, that we don't have permission to do something different, to break the rules and go do something that is the courageous step. So during that first semester, I moved around tables where I saw friends. And I was called a lot of names. I mean, I'm sure my sons know the names, but because I was a troublemaker, but I felt, why should they legislate to me that I have to sit at a specific table because of what I look like? Why can't I sit with my black friends sometimes, my Irish Catholic friends sometimes, because I was Catholic? You know, why can't I sit with my Jewish friends because they lived on my street? And so I mixed it up, and my brother got a lot of pressure from that. But after that, people started, I would say by Christmas time, other kids started following suit and doing the same thing. But it was something that I had grown up learning, that it is worthwhile to take a chance and push yourself a little harder. And sure, will your parents say to you, you know, I don't want you to embarrass yourself. You're going to stay on the path. You're going to stay on the path that your goal is set for. But at the same time, when you get into these institutions, you will find that even the most diverse institutions, even the most revered institutions, there are still things that have to be fixed there. And it's your job to fix them. Because sometimes the alumni, the long history of people say, well, that's the tradition here. And that was something that when I was finishing one of my books, called Best Companies for Minorities and Women, I wanted to find out, what was the final barrier for people of color and for women in corporate America? And a lot of them told me that the problem was getting into country clubs and golf clubs. And I said, well, why is that important? And they said, well, when you're at a country club or a golf club, you get introduced to other people who can help you in your business. It could be a network for you, like the kind of network that Eaglebrook can be for you. Andy had told you that one of my books is being turned into a TV series by Netflix. Once Netflix made the offer, Andy told me that one of the Netflix executives, wait for it, was an Eaglebrook alumnus. So I'm like, we're all out there. You're all out there. So don't go away from here and think like, okay, I did my 4 years, you know, I did my 1 year, 2 year, whatever, and I'm done. I mean, you come back here. My son is graduating from here, and but Pamela and I are going to stay here. We are going to be here. And the thing about it is that you call on your classmates. You call on these faculty. You call on the staff. You call on the alumni. And similarly, when we call you to say, you know, we hear that, you know, that you've started a new high-tech business, would you be willing to come back to campus and share your advice and experience with the students that are here? They'd be very grateful. And I was very grateful that when I learned about Larry Mark, a big producer out in Hollywood, when I was going out in Hollywood, Netflix was making the TV series, I found out that he was another Eaglebrook alum. So, I mean, the tentacles are wide. So I should say that when I, my last sort of example I'm going to share with you, like how in my own corporate world, how I learned the importance of rocking the boat, was when I was finishing this book, The Best Companies for Minorities and Women, they kept telling me these country clubs are very helpful to people in moving ahead in corporate America. So I decided to do the next logical thing. I left my law firm job temporarily and went undercover as a busboy. What I did is I created a fictional resume. I lied on my resume. Don't do that. Okay. What I did was, for the interest of journalism, I was actually 29 years old at the time. I said that I was 23. I contacted country clubs in Greenwich, Connecticut. It's not a big town, so you may not know where it is, but it was near where we lived, and there happened to be 8 country clubs there. So my goal was to find out, was it still true, and this was in the 1990s, that clubs discriminated against different groups of people, and was it still true that they were important networking opportunities? So with this fictional resume, I said that I was 23, I said I'd waited tables at 3 restaurants, I'd never waited tables. I contacted clubs that advertised in the Stamford, Connecticut newspaper and the Greenwich, Connecticut newspaper, nearby town. And I contacted the person was advertised in the classified section. I called the first club. The maitre d' was named Dora. And I called and I spoke to a woman named Dora and I said, I'm interested in interviewing for one of your waiter jobs. And she said, well, if you can come over right now, we have 8 jobs available. And so I got there about maybe like 15, 20 minutes later, dressed more like what you guys, but without the white pants, khaki pants, I'm a blazer, and walked up to the receptionist and she said, how can I help you? I said, I'm here to see Dora. And she says, there's no Dora working here. I said, well, I'm here to interview for one of the 8 jobs. She says, we don't have any jobs. And I said, well, I'm here to, isn't this that this club? And I showed her the ad in the paper. And she says, no, that's not the club. And I looked on the wall and I thought, wait a second. The club's name is there and it matches the one in the newspaper. I said, this is your club. And she said, if you don't leave right now, I'm calling security. It was that fast. So in other words, she was not going to let me get a job there. I was walking out, leaving the lobby of this club. I saw a young white guy, maybe 17, 18 years old, passed me. He was wearing jeans and sneakers. And he walked up to her, and I couldn't hear the conversation, but she went to a file cabinet and came back with a sheet of paper and a pen, and he filled it out. And so I thought, this is not what I think it is, but I'll go back. I said, I hate to be a pest, but that looks like he's filling out a job application. And she throws her hands up in the air, and she says, okay, I'll get you a job. I'll get your application. So I filled it out. I went back into the dining room where there were just workers setting the tables. And I asked one of the workers, is there a maitre d' here? And he said, do you mean Dora? And I said, yes. And he said, she's in the kitchen. I went to the kitchen. I found Dora. And Dora said, how can I help you? I said, I'm Larry Graham. I spoke to you on the phone. She says, you're the guy from the phone? I said, yes. And she says, oh gosh, I had no idea. She said, I can't hire you. And this is not Alabama in the 1950s. This is Connecticut in the 1990s. And she says, I can't hire you. So I had this experience at 5 other clubs where over the phone, I sounded like a great candidate, but I would get there within a half an hour, 40 minutes, and they wouldn't hire me. So finally at the 6th club I went to, the Greenwich Country Club, they had 3 callback interviews. And at my 3rd callback interview, they said, Lawrence, the staff and the membership, we've discussed it here, and we'd feel more comfortable if you'd work as a busboy instead of as a waiter. And I said, well, I've never worked as a busboy. And of course, I never worked as a waiter either, because that was my lie. And take it or leave it, they said. And just briefly, what I saw there was the kind of bias that I feel all of us have to fight against. It's not always very blatant. I was working in 2 different dining rooms. One was called the men's grill room. The other was called the mixed, M-I-X-E-D. It's where the women and kids ate. So the men ate in one room, the women and kids ate in the other room, and there was a kitchen in the middle. And I was working as a busboy, and all during my first few days there, a lot of the members and the workers said, Larry, are you going to move into the monkey house? Have you moved into the monkey house yet? And I said, what's the monkey house? And one of the members said, well, the monkey house is the name of our dormitory where our workers live. I said, well, why don't you call a dormitory for your workers at the club a monkey house? And with a straight face looking at me, he says, well, since the 1970s, all those jobs were held by blacks. And since the blacks were waiters and they were and cooks and bartenders, and we naturally called it the monkey house. And I said, I don't get it. And for those of you who read this article in this cover story in New York Magazine, it remains their best-selling issue in their 45-year history, is that people didn't get the point. Is that for them, the whole idea of bigotry was over their heads so long as they wore a suit and were respectful to people and went to their house of worship and didn't use the N-word or didn't burn crosses or didn't paint swastikas. They said, well, then I'm not doing anything wrong. And that's the kind of challenges we have to face when you get out into the real world. I thought I was going to lose my job in my Wall Street law firm. I thought my wife was going to leave me because she said, we just got married 3 months ago and you've done this. But she still became a partner at McKinsey. But I'm sharing you these stories because there'll be opportunities for you and there'll be experiences that you come and that you face. And other people might say, don't do it. Don't rock the boat. Play it safe. Vanilla, right down the middle. You don't have to do that. You can make yourself, you can reinvent yourself, and you can change the world. I want to thank all of you for inviting me here, and congratulations, class of 2017.